Your perfection.
Good morning.
Good morning, Lynn.
Good morning, Lynn.
Okay, can you tell me, are you able to see Lent, a time to renew? Welcome to worship. We're glad you're here.
Yes.
Excellent. Then I know I've done it right. I'm pleased because I am not at home this morning. As you can see, I am in our church sanctuary, which means I'm here all solo alone with no tech support. So we're going to pray that all goes well. We are glad that you are here to worship this morning. Please remember, if you do not wish to be seen as we are recording the service, to please darken your, click your little video camera icon. All right, let's take a look. I don't have a lot for a vaccination update this week. I just learned that we now have 16 people fully vaccinated and 7 have had their first. So that is great news. We are steadily climbing.
26.
All right. Wishes can come true. We're nearly there. Thank you for your generosity in supporting the Navajo mission. We ask that you would continue to do so, and we are going to try to get that taken care of before Easter. Big news today, pick up your palms day. From 10 to 11, we have drive-by giving, and we're going to give you palms. So you need not give a monetary gift in order to get a palm. Please make sure that you get your palms if you wish, and if you would like to have them for next week. Which is Palm Sunday next week. But we will have some finance people here, I hear, for those of you who may wish to do your monetary giving as well. And now let's prepare our hearts for worship.
She's at the church.
All right, and we have Anne who was going to do this for us. Can you see it all, Anne? That's my concern.
And I got Anne cut off. I'll try and get her back on. Lynn, we didn't hear the bells. Did you have your...
All right, then you know what? I'm going to have to stop the share, and I'm going to have to start again. I knew it was too good to be true, Ron.
I was watching. I thought I saw the bell move, but I didn't hear it.
Okay, let's try this. Thank you for letting me know. I really appreciate that. Let's see, here it is. Let's try again.
And can you get the...
Can I have a thumbs up if you could see that one? Mm-hmm. Terrific. Glad to hear it. Okay, so we're a little off kilter here. There we go. Anne, you are muted. I'm wondering if Roy is there and can unmute you. If you can't, we'll find someone else to help. Anne, why don't I put you on hold and I'll have you do a different thing, okay? And let's see, I did not get everybody given one. How about Ron? Would you be willing to do this for us, Ron?
I already got the mute off, so we're good. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him. How I've proved him over and over. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus. Oh, for the grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust him, precious Jesus, Savior friend. And I know that he is with me, will be with me to the end.
Beautiful. Thank you so much, Ron. All right, and now let's have a go. This one sometimes takes a minute to get it up and going.
There's four of them. Five.
There are. Here we let's see. Call to worship will be Patty and Wendy.
Blessed is the one who considers the poor. In the day of trouble, the Lord delivers him. Whoever despises his neighbor is a sinner.
But blessed is the one who is generous to the poor.
Whoever oppressed a poor man is a maker.
But he was generous to me.
Very nice. Thank you very much. And Linda has our opening hymn, which is In Christ There Is No East or West. That was beautiful. Thank you, Linda. Now, Anne, you're unmuted now. I'm wondering if you can see our prayer.
I bet Lori wishes he could do that to me. From Social Justice Resource Center, a prayer for an end to poverty. Let us pray for the poor, hungry, and neglected all over the world, that their cries for daily bread may inspire works of compassion and mercy among those to whom much has been given. Let us pray for the farmers with limited or marginal land throughout the world, for those who lack access to water and other resources, and for the light of research and the support services to shine in the lives of all peoples, all God's people. Prayers for the end of poverty. Let us pray for the health of women, children, and families around the world, especially for an end to child mortality, that in building healthy families, all God's people may be empowered to strengthen their communities and repair the breaches of poverty which divide nations and people. Lord, hear our prayer.
Amen.
Amen. That was a beautiful one. Be now, nice. Before I go on, I want to ask a couple of people if they can be on deck for reading the scripture lessons. And I'm wondering if Arjean would do the Old Testament and perhaps Desmond would do the gospel for us today. Okay.
I can do that.
Great. And before we do any more, Lynn Gonya, tell us about our bridges today.
Yes, we're going to be blessed with Roy Gorman doing a little, he's going to show us the bridge that he made, and he's going to tell us a story about what the bridge means. We were going to be blessed with Renee. She did build her bridge, but she's just not up to sharing today.
But that's okay. Desmond and Mary have one.
Oh, wonderful.
They were supposed to, I guess, be on today.
Yes, they were all going to. Yeah, good. Wonderful. Yeah, good.
So we'll have two.
Very good. And next week, Renee will be doing it, and Bill Houlihan. Thank you.
Super. So we'll start with Roy, and then we'll go to the Parkers.
Roy, you're on.
Maybe we'll start with the Parkers.
Oh, he's going to come in. Don't you? Oh, he's here right now.
Great. Can't wait.
And you won't excommunicate me, will you? Go ahead.
Very well.
Oh, dear.
Roy, we're so glad you're joining us this morning. This is a treat for us.
Let me give you a little background. This is supposed to be Anne's presentation. But as all of you know, she's shy, retiring, and only a few times in her career have I been able to get her up in front of a large group of people to sing. So, I threw this together for Anne, and I said, I've got a bridge, I have a troll. And so I thought of Billy Goat Gruff, the three of them. And in thinking about that, I said, this is a situation to where people listen to rumors and innuendos rather than judging on the actions. So, we have little Billy Goat Gruff. Him and his two brothers ravaged the countryside, but across the river were green meadows. So baby Gruff goes tiptoeing across the bridge. The troll comes out and says, I'm hungry, I'm gonna eat you. What does baby Billy Goat Gruff do? He says, oh, please don't eat me, kind sir. I've got a bigger brother coming across, wait for him. The troll, being kind and understanding and knowing what it is to be hungry, says, very well, you may pass. Based on that, who is the good guy and who is the bad guy? So, moving right along, here comes middle Billy Goat Gruff. He comes tiptoeing across the bridge. The troll comes out, and the troll says, I'm very hungry. I'm going to eat you up. What does middle-sized Billy Goat Gruff do? He says, oh, please don't eat me. My big brother will be coming soon. Eat him. Another case of misjudging the troll, because it said in this Norwegian fairy tale that he was very greedy, which can't be true, because if he is greedy, he would have eaten all of them. But he didn't. He understood the plight of middle-sized Billy Goat Gruff. Says, very well, I understand. You may pass. Middle-sized Billy Goat Gruff goes across the bridge, starts enjoying the sweet grass in the meadow. Then, here comes Big Billy Goat Gruff. The troll comes out, and Big Billy Goat Gruff butts him off the bridge, and he goes on down the river. Now, who in all of that was the good guy, and who was the bad guy? And this just shows you, don't depend on rumors and innuendo. Base your facts on actions.
Thank you, Roy. Well done. We appreciate that.
Good.
Nice. Thank you. All right, and now we have the Parkers with the bridge.
Well, actually, it's just me.
Just Mary.
Justin kind of backed out of this one.
Okay.
Is there any way I can get rid of the picture of the kids, okay. God's children of all ages, sharing bridges? That's taken up our whole screen. Do you see me just in the little square, or do you see me in the full screen?
I see you in the little square. If I stop the share, I have to start everything all over again, so it makes it complicated.
All right, we'll do it the best we can this way. Well, when I started thinking about bridges and journeys, I thought about our Christian journey of faith, and for all of us probably, but I thought of my own Christian journey of faith, and the way our Christian journeys are built on the Word of God in the Bible. And of course, we collected several Bibles over the years, so I'm going to make the abutments out of the Bibles and the bridge. Well, I'll show you the bridge after. My glasses down. I don't know if you can see me in the table.
Yes, we can.
This is a King James Bible that was given to my family when my children were young. And we used that Bible all the time the children were growing up. When I was in college, I took Bible Lit for 2 semesters. And when I did that, I used the Jerusalem Bible. And so I'm going to put that there, and hopefully the abutments are going to stay standing.
The thing is,
when Desmond retired finally, and we moved to Augusta to a retirement house, we joined a Bible study group. And this is the New Revised Standard Version Bible study at the Green Street Church. And now, I'll put it that way. Now, Desmond gave me this as a gift. This is the New Living Translation. And because we're getting toward the end of our journey, it's large print, which some of us need at this point. And that's the other. And the bridge itself, I used my childhood Bible. I don't know if you can see it, but this is Jesus and the children. And that's Zacchaeus up in the tree. So that's with the childhood Bible that took me on my journey from childhood to adulthood.
Well, that's the bridge you crossed over.
That's the bridge to cross over from the bridge. That's the childhood Bible is the bridge that took me from my childhood Christianity to my adult Christianity to my old age Christianity.
Excellent.
That was wonderful. Thank you. Beautiful, Mary.
Great.
Thank you so much. All right. Now, next we have our Old Testament lesson, and Jean Faulkner will be reading that.
Well, the Old Testament from Deuteronomy 15, verses 1 and 7 through 11. At the end of every 7 years, you must cancel debts. If anyone is poor among your fellow Israelites in any of the towns of the land of the Lord your God is giving you, do not be hard-hearted or tight-fisted toward them. Rather, be open-handed and freely lend them whatever they need. Be careful not to harbor this wicked thought. The 7th year, the year for canceling debts, is near, so that you do not show ill will toward the needy among your fellow Israelites and give them nothing. They may then appeal to the Lord against you, and you will be found guilty of sin. Give generously to them and do so without a grudging heart. Then, because of this, the Lord your God will bless you in all your work and in everything you put your hand to. There will always be poor people in the land. Therefore, I command you to be open-handed toward your fellow Israelites who are poor and needy in your land.
Beautiful. Thank you so much, Jean. And now we have some special music from our Bill.
Bye.
That was beautiful, Bill. Thank you so much. What a blessing.
Nice to be musical.
All right, now we have our gospel lesson, which Desmond will notice I have changed for today because I'm going to use the other on Good Friday. So go ahead, Reverend Parker. I'm going to let you go ahead and take it away.
The gospel according to St. Luke chapter 19, verses 1 through 10. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is the son of Abraham, for the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost."
The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you so much to everyone who's helped today. And can you believe we are nearly through our Lenten journey already? Look at all of the bridges we have looked at since the start of our sermon series. And today we will be bridging the economic divide. So today's bridge that we're going to focus on is called a tide arch bridge. It incorporates a metal arch structure supported by vertical ties between the arch and the deck. These ties hold carry the tension. The decking also is strengthened with a cord. This is the Piscataqua River Bridge. It connects Kittery, Maine with Portsmouth, New Hampshire. Construction began on May Day of 1968 and was completed the 1st of November in 1972. I learned this sad fact, tragically four workers died in the bridge's construction. A memorial plaque for the four men is on the main side, visible from a Route 103. I don't know if any of you had known that. So I have a little history our family does in this with this bridge. My brother, when he had finished his schooling, he got a summer job, some summer employment working for the state of New Hampshire, and he had to do painting of that bridge. So my brother has been way up on the top of that. Ooh. So it's kind of interesting. That's why I chose that one. All right, well, I'm going to actually come back to that. We'll get started on our morning message. Sometimes statistics can be helpful, and we're going to be looking at the economic divide today, so we're going to focus on some poverty. So I thought perhaps we should begin today's message by looking at some statistics on poverty. Now, these are slightly dated so that you know they are from 2018, but that was the most current information I found. I think we can all safely assume that in a pandemic world, the poverty we'll be looking at today has only gotten worse worldwide. So let's go ahead and take a look. I'm sure you'll be as surprised as I was at these figures. Poverty threshold using the 2018 statistics from Poverty USA website. A family of three people, if you make $19,985 or less, then you are considered to be in poverty. And so take a look at those numbers. Those are all going to be different for, I'm hoping you can see them all, goes right up to a family of nine or more, which would require $51,393. I just can't imagine being able to support 9 or 10 people on that salary. Who lives in poverty in the USA? Federal government sets the poverty threshold, and anyone making less than that amount lives in poverty. 12.9% are women and 10.6% are men. Poverty does not strike all demographics equally. Example, poverty rates within these households in 2018, married couples, 4.7%, single father homes, 12.7%, single mother homes, 24.9%, and people living with a disability, 25.7%. This is by age. 16.2% of children, or that translates to 1 in 6, are living in poverty. And as for seniors, 9.7%. But when rising costs of healthcare and costs for medications are factored in, that number raises the senior poverty rate to 14.1%. By ethnicity, Native Americans have the highest poverty rate among all Americans. And for that reason, we are doing a mission this Lent, because we have known that the Navajo especially have been hit very hard by COVID-19 because they do not have water. You cannot be hygienic when you do not have water. Deep poverty and close to poverty. 5.3% of the population, or 17.3 million people, live in deep poverty with incomes below 50% of those thresholds. So remember, if 20,000 were the threshold, then that means that they live 5.3%, or 7.3 million people make only $5,000 a year. And 29.9% of the population, or 93.6 million people, live very close to the poverty threshold, but just above. Only a paycheck or two puts them over the threshold. Now, in Jesus's time, they did not have statistics or poverty threshold scales, but we do know that 90% of people lived in poverty in Jesus's day. Many babies born did not live to the age of 5. Many children did not live to become teenagers of those that did live to be the age of 5. And the average life expectancy of an adult was only about 46 years old. Living into one's 60s was a very big rarity. We still see those kind of statistics today from places in Africa. Why? Lack of clean water, lack of sanitation, lack of healthy food, lack of proper housing, and lack of good health care. In a word, poverty. But for today, we're going to stick close to home, right here in the great state of Maine. And so we'll get back now to our message. What do we get from all these statistics? Well, we know that poverty affects everyone. No group is exempt from it. We know also that certain groups are affected more severely. Race, for example, is a factor. We can see how Native peoples, African Americans, and Hispanic populations contain higher rates of poverty. We also know that when it comes to the economic divide, poverty is a very big problem. While some people have plenty, others have precious little. If you are a family of 4 trying to survive on only $25,000 a year, it's going to be pretty difficult to pay for housing, heat, electricity, food, transportation, and medical costs. People living below the poverty threshold certainly can't be setting aside savings for a rainy day, nor for retirement. Now, in our scripture today, both of our texts deal with poverty. In the Deuteronomy text that Jean shared for us, we saw that provisions were made for those who didn't have much. It was very clear that God's people are to give generously with a happy heart, not clutching what we have with a tight fist and through clenched teeth. We also saw that very interesting provision that God had given to folks in order to give them all a brand new start. Every seventh year, there was to be a year of Jubilee. That is a year when all debts were canceled. Now, back then, if you owned money, you would work for someone to pay off what you owed them. But at the end of the 7 years, that responsibility was over and any remaining debt was supposed to be canceled. The slate was to be wiped clean for everyone. A brand new tabula rasa, we might say, for the entire population. Or in technology terms, it was a reset back to original factory settings. It was liberating and a way to get everyone back on a more equal ground, or so it was supposed to be. It must have given great hope to people too, because you knew there was always light at the end of the tunnel. Maybe you had to work off alone in labor, but it would not be forever. Then at the time of our gospel lesson, we see Jesus showing us another layer on the cake, shall we say. The story of Zacchaeus that we love, and I thought it was so wonderful that Mary had showed us that picture from her children's Bible. How perfect was that? Zacchaeus had been a tax collector for the Romans. So now not only do we have the local Jewish laws, but there's also enormous taxation from the Roman Empire. Rome would find local people to do their dirty work. So Zacchaeus was one of those locals. He collected taxes for Rome, and like all tax collectors of his day, he added on extra, which he kept for himself. So despised were these publicans, or tax collectors, as they were commonly called, that they were not even allowed into the synagogues to worship. Remember those statistics that we began with. We talked about Jesus's day. 90% of people lived in poverty, thanks to all those taxes. We can understand then why tax collectors were despised. 90% of the population lived in poverty from overtaxation, and yet these very people the tax collectors took more from. They would amass an easy, very comfortable lifestyle off the backs of their fellow Jewish sisters and brothers. The haves got richer while the have-nots gave and gave what they didn't have and became poorer and poorer. Now, despite these tax collectors being hated by the people and being shunned from the worshiping community, Jesus welcomed them in. One of his very own disciples, Matthew, had been a tax collector. And in today's gospel, Jesus went into the home of Zacchaeus. But by doing this, Zacchaeus, he had a changed heart, and his changed heart led to a change in his life and the way he lived it. "Look, Lord," he declared, "here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay four times the amount back." Talk about a changed life. Everyone would have been happy had he simply said, "I won't take above and beyond what I'm supposed to." But Zacchaeus was not satisfied with that. He understood grace. He understood compassion. He sought what we call restorative justice. He wanted to fix the wrongs that he had committed, and with interest. So what are the lessons for us today from this story of Zacchaeus? This short frame man turned into a giant in the faith. I think one of the best lessons we learned from Zacchaeus is to try our hardest to level the playing field wherever we can. We can't level everyone's playing field, but if we focus on our own, we'll be headed in the right direction. Another way to put that is to seek out opportunities to help wherever we can, to offer support, just as Zacchaeus did, to those who needed it. Now, the reason I chose the Tide Arch Bridge for today's message is because the Tide Arch Bridge has a decking that is reinforced with extra support to help carry the load. That special reinforced decking is connected with many other vertical ties that help alleviate all the tension. That is a wonderful visual aid for us all. When many of us come together, just like the vertical ties on that bridge, and we do our part to help the support structures that are in place to help alleviate poverty, then we can really make a difference. Now, we may all do that in different ways. Certainly, our church family has a long history in this work. Every year, we support several missions, most of which go to support structures for alleviating poverty. We support the local food pantries weekly. We have supported Redbird Mission in Appalachia. We've supported a well for a school in Africa, and we're currently buying a well and solar energy for a Navajo family. These are all ways that we are in mission in our own community, in our nation, and in our world to support those who live in poverty. This is how we bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ our Lord. We do our part, even if that part seems tiny to us. Even if all it is donating a meal to a family when they are in need, or sending hygiene supplies to a domestic violence shelter, or donating socks to Preble Street for the homeless. When we all come together to give in our various ways to the supports that are there, we can bear very heavy loads. Loads like the Piscataqua River Bridge, which carries 6 lanes of Interstate 95 traffic. But you don't have to take it from me. Let's hear from some of our own folks how they are helping in their own little corners of the world. Now, I was hoping to start with our Anne, but we've got to get her unmuted. Is Roy nearby, Anne? If he's not, what we'll do is we'll put you second. I'm going to have Ron go first, and then we'll end with you, okay? All right, Ron, you're up.
Sorry, Anne, I hit you on mute.
Oh, did you?
Thanks. So I've been working with child nutrition, I think, you know, for, I think I've done 20 to 30 years in working with child nutrition across the state. So in that world, remember the meal programs recognize that not every child has access to food at home. During World War II was when that first really became apparent, when the young men going into the draft just, you know, were underweight and they couldn't really pass the physical at all. So they put together the National School Lunch Program. And that's really where it came out of, that piece where families aren't always able to provide everything they need. But the lunch program in the schools, you know, it's much more. It's breakfast, it's lunch, there's snacks, everything else, summer meals. But they're all decided on this economic dividing line that we have. And it's based on that poverty measure that Lynn just brought up. But as a director, I had to review that family's income application every year and approve it or disapprove it based upon that line. So if that family of three had a total gross income at or below 185%, which, so about times two, so that family of three, if they were earning up to $72,000 a year, they could qualify for free or reduced price meals, yeah, to take that load off the family, to help them out, to make their dollars stretch further, what they did. But you know what? If they earned more than $1, even $1 above that limit, they did not qualify. So I had a lot of phone calls in every district, every year, it didn't matter where it was, about trying to explain this to families. You know, they would call talking about, well, we have all these bills. I've got doctor visits for the kids. I got medication. Yeah. I got a car repair that just, you know, the transmission went in my car, or I have a traffic fine. And, you know, I had to explain that those don't count. In that line that we decided and the government and us set up, the economic dividing line was created, is built on that gross income. It doesn't matter what your bills are. Isn't that crazy? But you know what? That's how it works. But you know, we can all remember that time when an unexpected bill pushed us to our limit. You know, I borrowed Cindy Estabrook's car from church so many times when we were starting out because I had to get to my job in Portland. My car was broken and I had to use to get there somehow. But you know what? When, you know, how do you get there? And how do you get to the store for groceries? So only 41% of Americans could handle that unexpected bill of $1,000. Most of them, you know, 41% could find savings or cash or use their credit cards, right? But you know what? So many people don't have access to credit. They don't have access to a bank in their neighborhood, or they don't have family that can put together $1,000. So those are the families that I really get concerned about because they're that $1 over and I can't do a thing about it on that one. But so that those families can be pushed, they might be in poverty. They probably are in poverty based just because of their bills. But during the pandemic, all of the school meals have been at no cost for any family. Our federal government recognized that sudden unemployment, the closure of the schools, and those immense new bills that families have to face were just too big. So they erased the economic dividing line. And so those meals are at no charge for any student on any day. So sometimes we can build a bridge across those divides that we create. And that's really, you know, kind of my role working in child nutrition and seeing what happens with the economic concerns of families.
Thank you so much, Ron. That was really great. And now we have our Anne Lagarde. She's going to be sharing with us about her work at the food pantry.
It's a two-way street, if you know what I mean. It's we go up on Friday mornings, get up at 5 o'clock, and thank God for Henry and them. And we go down to the store and we pick up the day-old food. Then we bring it to the food pantry and we go through it because sometimes it isn't the greatest food. And we don't like to give people something that's going to make them sick. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's like a two-way street. It gives you, you do it because it gives you a feeling of giving back to the community, something of what you've got or you have received. And we do it every Friday. In fact, she's going to open, Pastor Lynn, did she tell you? One Saturday a month now.
Good.
Yeah. And of course, there's very few of us because of the pandemic. She's not receiving volunteers because she doesn't want to get mixed up in that. So we're few, but we're mighty, if you know what I mean. But yeah. We do it every Friday. And you know, you do it for yourself as much as you do it for the people that you're helping. And we have people come in there that say, I don't know what I would do if I couldn't come, if I didn't have here. And the same with Joanne.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you've got to give her credit too.
Oh,
those
yes.
People every single week, they go and pick up food. And it used to be that we would pick up, like there would be 9 boxes. Now we have 25 boxes that come to us. And most of this stuff is very, very good stuff. I have to say that for Hannaford. And that they give this, of course, money for it, but just the same. It used to be thrown away.
Right.
And, you know, it's you do it as much for yourself as you do it for the people you're helping.
Thank you, Anne. How many years have you worked there?
Ron, when did Cheryl have her foot fixed, that operation on her foot?
Oh, I'm thinking 8 years.
Well, more than that, isn't it? Because I think
probably she's had a couple things fixed.
Oh, because I know that's how I inherited this. I was taking it over for a week or that's a couple funny. Weeks until she got back. And then she says, I don't think I can do it. Do you mind? And I said, okay. But do you know something? When you're older, you want to be needed. And And it's nice to be needed because then you don't feel as old.
I want to add something, Anne, if you'll let me. In the pandemic, all of the youngest volunteers bailed. It was Anne and Lynn Gagne who for the longest time stayed in there every week doling out food. And so it's really interesting. Most of the volunteers there are from our church. And of course we sponsor Joanne Groder and everything that the pantry that the smaller pantry doesn't use goes over to Joanne. And so there's a nice partnership that's beginning to happen.
We had 25 boxes.
Yep. You know, all right.
But you've got to say thank you to Henry.
Yes.
I mean, what would we do without Henry?
Yeah.
Sometimes Henry he's cantankerous, but he's Henry.
All right. Anne, thank you so much for your willingness to share as well. And thank you, Ron. That was really a blessing. And now let's go up to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, we thank you for this day and we remember to thank you for all that you have blessed us with. We remember the words of Jesus who said, to those who have been given much, much is required. And so we pray, Lord God, that you would continue to bless us and that we would continue to bless others from the generosity you have given us, that we would use that same measure and be generous in supporting those who are in poverty. Lord, we come before you now lifting up the names of all those who are in need of prayer from within our community and within our families and our nation and world. We lift up the Sharp family, Lord, in the loss of Dana. We remember to pray for our Renee, who is still grieving the loss of her brother. We continue to pray for our Jean, who is healing after her surgery, and we continue to pray for our Patty, who has had her first appointment with the cardiologist. And now, Lord, we ask you to hear the names, first names of those others we lift up today.
Wendy Dave. And Paul.
Dave.
Cliff and Mike.
Tammy, Jane, John.
Annie and Billy.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And now we pray together the prayer Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We want to thank you all for the support you have given us financially. And we remember the words of John Wesley, our founder, make all you can, save all you can, and give all.
Yeah, I got a story to tell you.
All right, and I'm going to ask our Linda if she will do our final hymn for us, please. The Poor as Jesus's Bosom Friends. This is a Charles Wesley hymn, not in our hymnal, but it's perfect for today.
Because I let Linda stay out. Enough. and she opened her mouth. Belongs in my family.
Hereditary.
Hereditary.
Amen to that. Thank you, Linda. And those lyrics are just so, so beautiful and so perfect for today. And now as you go forth this week to build bridges of peace, may you feel the ever-loving presence of God the Father, the compassion of Christ the Son, and the guidance of the Holy Spirit as you go. Amen. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen.
All right. I am here and I am ready to give out your palms. So for those of you who are would like to do so, please come on over and drive on by and we'll give those out.
Plant a palm.
God bless you all.
If it was too cold. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.